Hi guys, this is Raish from Vaishayas and we are going to continue the History NCERT series. Class 9, all the major chapters we have done. Now we have three chapters, chapter 6, 7, 8. Chapter 6 is actually about the peasant's life, but it is dealing more of North American peasant's life, the prairie land and all. I'll show you, and we are not going to cover it, okay? I'll just skip those pages. I'll show you whichever pages we are skipping, and in case you need it still, you can tell me, but I am telling you for UPSC, we don't need it, okay? So maybe geography optional series students can go through that textbook alone. Okay, I'm not making a video for that, but I'll show you which all pages I'm going to skip. At the end of this chapter, we have this Indian perspective of peasants, where the China is also coming in, and the story of opium trade, which is also a major event in history. Okay, so that opium trade alone we'll cover, maybe 5 to 10 pages are there. So that we'll cover in this particular video. So it will be comparatively shorter video than other previous chapters. And the next 7 and 8 are not at all relevant for any of the optionals or any subject of UPSC. That I'll be doing in one single video, chapter 7 and 8. Chapter 7 is about the evolution of cricket and sports in India and across the world. In that one table is there where Gandhiji's aspect or something is there, Gandhiji's perspective. That alone we'll see. And in the chapter 8, it is again about the clothing style. So there again, all the European clothing style, the evolution of dresses and all. And the last, there is again a box about the Khadi, okay, Gandhi and Khadi. So that maybe we'll cover. So that will be again a small video. Chapter 7 and 8 will be the next one. So just watch quickly and just do away with it. We don't need much, okay? The chapter 6, let's go ahead. I'll tell you what we are going to cover and what we are going to skip. Okay, based on that, you can give in comment section whether you need more. So here, if you see previous chapters, we saw the pastures and forest in detail. That those were very important chapters, the previous two chapters, because tribe names were there. And then here again, they are telling about the peasant life, but they are starting with England and USA. So I'm going to show you the pages now, which we are not going to take. Okay, so we see coming of modern agriculture in England. Okay, so again, lot of stories, their type of agriculture, the farming concept, the commercial agriculture. It is lot and lot of stories. As you see map also, it's their locations. We don't need it, right? UPSC is not going to ask in prelims, means nowhere they are going to ask this thing. Okay, their grains demand, their threshing machines, these all things, at least first 10 to 12 pages I think they are doing the same thing. Okay, again, see the countryside of their land, we don't need it. See England again, England is important. We need it for the Brexit or something that we learn in international relations. Other than that, for history perspective, we don't have to study their history. We have more than enough to study for India and world itself. So we don't want these things. Okay, so again, Napoleonic war happened, and again shortage happened, their lifestyle. So again, the dust bowl bread basket. So now it is USA. So USA and states and all, do you think we need it? We never have come across any single question about the farming styles of USA. Okay, so we don't need this. So going like this down, we'll see the next chapter, chapter number 3 of this particular section, that is the 6th chapter. That is important for us because it is India and China and the opium trade. So here, the Indian farmer and opium production, this is what we are going to deal in this particular video. Okay, so I just wanted to show you those pages, that is why this much time we wasted now. Now we'll begin. So here, British rule was gradually established in India after the Battle of Plassey, that we know. Over the period of colonial rule, the rural landscape was radically transformed. The British saw land revenue as a major source of government income. We saw this in the previous two chapters also. To build the resources of the state, efforts were made to impose a regular system of land revenue, increase revenue rate, and expand the area of cultivation. Okay, so regular system of land revenue, increase the revenue rate, expand the area under cultivation. So profit, that's all they cared. As cultivation expanded, the area under forest and pasture declined, obviously. Okay, all this created many problems for peasants and pastoralists. They found their access to forest and grazing lands increasingly restricted by the rules and regulations. We saw that wasteland rules are there, forest act rules are there, grazing tax was there, then criminal tribes act was there. There are many things because of which their life was getting declined or degraded. Now in the colonial period, rural India also came to produce a range of crops in the world market. In the early 19th century, indigo and opium were two major crops, like the commercial crops. Indigo story in detail I have done in my Spectrum series, where we'll see the Gandhi's entry into national movement, where we saw Champaran movement, that was done. And in another NCERT chapter, I told you about the indigo story in the 1859, that is even before Gandhiji was born, there was a blue rebellion and indigo protest, okay, that was there, and I discussed in detail in one of the NCERTs. Please watch everything in order, you will understand. So indigo was done. So it is opium that we will deal in this particular chapter. Okay, so by the end of the century, peasants were producing sugarcane, cotton, jute, wheat, and other export products, okay, to feed the population of urban Europe. So it was majorly for them only, okay, and to supply the mills of Lancashire and Manchester in England. So everything was their profit. It's not for subsistence, it is for commercial farming. Okay, what is subsistence and commercial farming? If you don't know, watch my Ramesh Singh playlist, Economics, chapter 8. Okay, now what happened, we'll see. a taste for tea. You know, England were crazy about tea. We have seen a lot of posters in multiple chapters, the Lipton tea poster, then one pleasure tea poster. They had different, they had too much craving for this Indian or Chinese tea that they would do anything to get tea, okay. Tons and tons of tea was getting exported in this much faraway land, okay. You know, that time there is no that much big sophisticated transport system. So imagine how much time it will take to take tea from here to there. Still they wanted it, okay. Like present day USA is doing that. Present day USA, sorry, not USA, UAE, Middle East. Middle East needs a lot of things like that from India, okay. They are addicted to some things which are produced in India. So we'll see the story of the 18th century. The English East India Company was buying tea and silk from China, okay, for sale in England. That was what was happening. As tea became popular English drink, the tea trade became more and more important. In 1785, about 15 million pounds of tea, okay, 15 million pounds of tea was being imported to England. By 1830, the figure had jumped to over 30 million pounds, okay. In fact, the profits of East India Company came to be dependent upon tea trade. So tea became that much important. That is why that in Northeast and all, that much tea plantation was there, because it is closer to China also. Now, this created a problem. England at this time produced nothing that could be easily sold in China. Okay, so this England people had this problem. They won't give money. Okay, they don't want to empty the treasury because it has to come from the government, right? They are all company people, East India Company. So what they do is they'll produce something in India and with that they will exchange and then they will get the tea. So that is what they used to do. But problem was at this time, England did not produce anything too much in bulk that they could exchange for this huge amount of tea. So that was a problem now. So in China, who was ruling? The Confucian rulers of China, the Manchus, okay, they were ruling now. So they were suspicious of these foreign merchants. They feared that the merchants will again come and interfere in local politics because they don't want the state of India to happen there, okay. They don't want these people to come and enter into politics. So they would, they will stop these goods, they will stop these entry of foreign goods and all. Okay, in such a situation, how would Western merchants finance the tea trade? How could they balance their trade? This was the questions they had in their mind. They could buy tea only by paying in silver, and I told you it has to come from the treasury. Okay, and they did not want to deplete their wealth. It's given here, deplete its wealth. So merchants therefore looked for ways to stop this loss of silver. So that is why opium came into their rescue. Okay, opium is something which is having medicinal property, but it is also we will get addicted to it. Okay, so that is one problem. So opium was such a commodity, the Portuguese actually had introduced it. Okay, now UPSC will put statement like the British introduced opium into China. Okay, so that will be a wrong statement. It's the Portuguese. Okay, Portuguese introduced opium into China. Okay, opium was however known primarily for its medicinal properties and used in minuscule quantities for certain type of medicines. The Chinese were aware of the dangers of opium addiction. Okay, and the emperor had forbidden also it in the territories. Okay, the sale except for medicinal purpose, it was banned in China. But Western merchants, you know, they will do anything to get their profit motive done. So illegal trade happened, okay, opium, even war will happen, opium wars that we'll learn in some other chapter. It was unloaded in a number of seaports of Southeast China and carried by local agents to the interiors. By the early 1820s, about 10,000 crates were being annually smuggled into China. Okay, so this is what happened. And this map will tell you the whole story. If you see the direction also, the arrow from Calcutta to Canton in China. So this place, opium will go from China, tea will go to England, and in between England and India, if you see, it is bi-directional. So most of the things are going here and there. So same thing in this box they have given, okay, tea from China to England, opium from India to China, and also between India and England it was both ways, okay. And both ways what it will go, earlier it was like India was the home of cotton production and all, but these people made Indian industry to decline. And they will just now take this raw materials now, export of raw materials of silk and cotton and the food grains from here, and in return what it will come, the finished products will come to India, manufactured goods, and that was the decline of Indian artisanal production. So this is what Shashi Tharoor tells each and every speech. His new book also, I think, Pax India, read that book or watch his videos, okay. Speeches are excellent when it comes to this British destroying our this thing industries, okay. About that he tells very good speeches. So when the English cultivated a taste for Chinese tea, the Chinese became addicted to opium. Okay, so that was what was happening. People of all classes took to the drug, shopkeepers, peddlers, officials, army men, everyone, okay, addicted to this opium. Okay, now again they were sending some officers, actually some Lin's, so he is actually a special officer, okay. This box they are showing like he is going and raiding the ships and he is able to capture a lot of people, okay. There's arrested 1,600 men, confiscated 11,000 pounds, so they started to take steps against it. So that is there about this book. We don't need to go in detail. A British doctor in Canton put the figure at 12 million, I think the money which was raided or something. As China became a country of opium addicts, British trade in tea flourished. The return from opium sale financed the tea purchase in China. So now this is all about the trade, but this opium has to be cultivated, right? It has to be cultivated in India. So now we'll see that story. So how did the peasants do it, or how did the British force them to do it? So when the British conquered Bengal, they made a determined effort to produce opium in the lands under their control. As the markets for opium expanded in China, larger volumes of opiums flowed out of Bengal ports. Before 1767, no more than 500 chests, that is of 2 mounds each. Mound is actually a weight of measure, okay, measure of weight, okay, it's here. So, were being exported from India. Within 4 years, the quantity trebled. 100 years later, in 1870, the government was exporting about 50,000 chests. You can see 500 chests to 50,000 chests in 100 years. Supplies had to be increased to feed this booming export rate, but this was not easy. How could the cultivators be persuaded to grow opium? For a variety of reasons, they were unwilling to turn their fields over to poppy. First, the crop had to be grown on the best land, on fields. So, same like indigo case, okay, they wanted best land, they wanted fertile land, and they wanted people to grow this instead of the usual rice or pulses which they used to grow, okay. So, they had to find out some way to force them to do this. So, cultivation of opium was a difficult process also, that is another challenge, because it is a very delicate plant, okay. So, cultivators had to spend long hours nurturing it. So, that is one third challenge you can tell. So, finally, the price of the government paid to the cultivators for opium, that also was a problem, because how will these people gain revenue, British? They not only need tea, they need the profit also. So, they buy from the peasants at some price, then at a higher price, they'll give it to China. So, that middle money, whatever comes, with that only they'll do the rest of the things. So that also was one challenge for them. So unwilling cultivators were made to produce opium through a system of advances. In the rural area of Bengal and Bihar, there were large number of poor peasants. They never had enough to survive. It was difficult for them to pay the rent or to buy food. From the 1780s, such peasants found their village headman, Mahato, they call, okay, village headman, giving them more money advances to produce opium. So it's like tempting them to buy, because those people don't have food or clothing or anything, and they don't have money to pay the rent. So these people will keep on giving loans, like present day China is doing the same thing to Sri Lanka, Pakistan and all, giving lot of soft loans, and finally they take away their land. Now Sri Lanka, you know, the Hambantota port is taken by China already for 99 years lease, okay. Now, next will be Pakistan. Pakistan, mostly the Gilgit Baltistan region or the Gwadar port, okay, both may be China's property soon, okay. It's almost China only is there, China's administrators are there, China's army is there, but officially also maybe it will go away now. Then next problem will come, because Indian land is also there in between, okay. So when offered a loan, the cultivators were tempted, like I told, and then they will be forced to grow the opium. That is what happened. It was the government opium agents who were advancing the money to the headman. So it was government only indirectly giving to headman. If they go directly, the cultivators may not like it. So they will give to the village headman, and village headman will give to the cultivators. Okay. So by taking the loan, the cultivator was forced to grow opium on a specified area of land and hand over the produce to the agents once the crop has been harvested. He had no option of planting the field with a crop of his choice or of selling his produce to anyone but the government agent. So he can do only this crop and he can sell only to the government agent. And so it was like a strict system. Okay. And he had to accept the low price also. That is also another problem. So the problem could have been partly solved by increasing the price of opium. Okay, they could have increased a little bit, right? But they won't care, right? They won't care about the peasants. The government was reluctant to do it. Wanted to produce opium at cheap rate and sell it at a higher price to opium agents in Calcutta, who then shipped it to China. So this was the path. This difference between the buying and selling price was the government opium revenue. I told you this. The prices given to the peasants were so low that by the early 18th century, angry peasants began agitating for higher prices and refused to take advances. In region around Banaras, cultivators began giving up opium cultivation. Okay, they produced sugarcane and potatoes instead. Many cultivators sold off their crop to traveling traders, okay, paikars. So this is one term, maybe UPSC will pick it up. Traveling traders are paikars, like our Banjarans and all, you can tell, okay. So they were offering to this. By 1773, the British government in Bengal had established a monopoly, okay, to trade in opium. No one else was legally permitted to take this product. But 1820s, one problem happened. British found out, like, inside India, within India, central India and Rajasthan, illegally these princely states, which are not under British control, there this opium trade is happening. And peasants are cultivating, they are getting higher prices also. So there was something which was happening, okay, at higher prices, which was going to peasants. So obviously, they will not give it to the government agents, right? So some things were happening by the 1820s. 1773, they had monopoly, but 1820, other people were also doing. So armed band of traders were carrying on this trade. To the British, this trade was illegal. It was smuggling and it had to be stopped. So government monopoly had to be retained. It therefore instructed its agents posted in the princely states to confiscate all opium and destroy the crops. So they were, if they go down get the profit, they won't allow others also to get the profit. Okay, they want that monopoly because they thought they were the government or they are the whole rulers of the entire decisions made in India. The conflict between the British government, peasants and local traders continued as long as opium production lasted. We should not, however, think that experience of all the peasants in colonial India were like those of the opium cultivators. So more things will be discussed in some other chapter. That is the thing. Conclusion. Rural areas in different parts of the world changed in the modern period. While looking at these changes, we must remember that the pattern was not the same everywhere. All sections of rural people were not affected in the same way. Some gained, some lost. Nor was the history just concluding. Okay, just telling it is diverse. It's not like everywhere it was the same fate. So again, some picture, packed chest of opium being taken to Ghazipur railway station in the 19th century. So see, they are taking boxes and boxes of these things. Okay, opium. So this is about this chapter. See, pause this and see the questions if you are able to answer. But USA, UK thing, don't even bother. If something is there to opium, just do that. Okay. Like this question, write a paragraph on how the British insisted on farmers growing opium in India. If you are able to answer that, then this chapter is done. So I'll come up with that last irrelevant chapters, chapter 7 and 8, one single video. Then we'll be done with class 9th and then we'll soon start class 10th also. Okay. Give your feedback, subscribe to our channel and join our Facebook page to get the MCQs. Okay. So till we come with the next video, thank you and have a nice day.